created all that is, including people. God's creation was good and pure. It was a paradise where there was no suffering, no pain, where all things lived in balance and harmony, where all animals and humans lived at peace with one another, where humans were the caretakers of creation, and where all humans and animals ate off of the abundant plant life and fruit-bearing trees in the paradise. There was no need to hunt and to kill other things, for all existed to live and to love and to attain abundant life. In the beginning, people were in relationship with their Creator. Both Creator and creation were dependent on each other. The Creator sought to have a love-filled and a mutual relationship with the creation. And in return, the Creator provided all the creation needed out of that love. Yet, there's always a yet in these kinds of stories, aren't there? Yet, from the beginning, humans sought something other than a mutual, loving relationship with their Creator. Humans didn't like being dependent. In fact, some humans today on a continent called North America celebrate something called Independence Day, where we balk at the idea of being dependent. Humans didn't like being dependent on anyone but themselves. And they sought to discover their own independence. They didn't like the fact that they were ignorant, and they sought to know things for themselves. And it's kind of funny, because where some people see it as ignorance, others may call it innocence. But humans weren't content with that. In time, humans came to discover things and began to attain knowledge. Knowledge of the world around them, knowledge of right from wrong, knowledge of good and evil, knowledge of their own identity as individuals. Monty Python comes to mind, but I won't go there. And knowledge of their own sexuality and ability to create. How many of you have read the book Frankenstein or The Modern Prometheus by Mary Shelley? For us two who have read that novel, we know the disastrous ends of our ability to create. And as those of us who are parents also know the beautiful ends of our ability to create. Humans took the knowledge they had and began to define themselves, understanding themselves apart from God, allowing their knowledge to define themselves and the world around them. Humans no longer needed to depend on what God said they should do, because they could tell themselves what they should do. Humans no longer needed a God to define what the world was created for. For humans could define what the world could do for them. They no longer needed their Creator, but became creators unto themselves. And their acknowledgement of God went from a mutual relationship to a relationship of one-sided expectations. Thunder strikes, and we build an altar to God, praying for the thunder to go away. In fact, that's how Martin Luther, by the way, became a monk. He was in law school, and he was traveling along the road, and a fierce storm overtook him, and lightning was striking to his left and to his right, and fearing for his life, he said, "Save me, God! I'll become a monk! I'll become a monk!" Well, he lived through the storm, and he took his word seriously and became a monk.
He wasn't cut out to be a lawyer.
Evidently not. Evidently not. Though he certainly did bring the law, so to speak, to the Roman Catholic Church. Or the freedom from the law, depending on which way you look at that. But we went from a mutual relationship with God to a relationship of one-sided expectations. God, what can you do for me? God, what can you do for my family? God, what can you do for our church? God, what can you do for our world? My friends, the reality is that we humans have knowledge to a degree, but our knowledge is limited to our own subjectivity. Now, what do I mean by subjectivity? Does anybody want to take a stab at what I mean by subjectivity? We live in a world that cherishes science. And science prides itself, the natural sciences anyway, pride themselves on being objective. We take evidence A and evidence B and evidence C, and we collect all of the evidence we can, and from that evidence we formulate a theory which we believe we can prove by doing X, Y, and Z in a number of controlled or uncontrolled environments and experiments. And so eventually we will have knowledge because we have proven it, and it's objective, theoretically. The problem is, in order for that objective evidence to be processed, it has to go through a subjective mind, which has its own agendas and its own biases and its own ideas of what truth is and what truth is not. And so the same evidence that one could say, look, there is a God, is the same evidence that another one could say, look, we're here by random happenstance. The problem is, subjectivity is human nature. We all have minds, and those minds have lived as long as they have and have experienced the world through the lenses that we have experienced them. We process the things that happen to my life is not the same as Linda's life. Linda's life's not the same as Susan's life. Susan's life's not the same as Harold's life, nor is Harold's the same as Ray's. We all experience things differently. We all have different things that inform us. And over time, we're all processing things differently. We're all listening to my words, but each and every one of you are thinking different things about them. That's human nature. That's subjectivity. So we have knowledge, but that knowledge isn't pure. That knowledge isn't big picture. That knowledge is processed through our own subjectivity. So we have knowledge, but to a limited degree. We see ourselves in everything we know. And it is that kind of self-centered tendency that is at the root of sin. Somebody once did sin like visually by spelling it with lowercase s, uppercase I, lowercase n. So it was the S and N almost weren't there, but the I was right there in the middle. And I think that is a good visual to understand what sin is, or at least what's at the root of sin. What's at the root of sin, my friends, is that we put ourselves over and above everything else. Everything we take in, we process through the big I, and then we project it outward and call it reality. Sometimes it is reality, sometimes it is not reality. From the first Adam, by the way, Adam comes from the word Adama, which means man, or in today's gender-neutral language, human, which still has man in it. I find that funny. Anyway. Adam is simply Adam because he was human. He was man, as in mankind. From the first Adam, we got sin. Because in his own subjectivity and in his own desire to be independent from God and to be like God in some ways. Not necessarily in an evil, twisted, mini, you know, Dr. Evil kind of way from Austin Powers, but in the sense that he wanted to know, he wanted to learn, he wanted to create. From the first Adam, we got sin, and as a result, we got death. And not death just in the physical sense, but more importantly, death in the spiritual sense. Who knows if in paradise Adam would have lived on and on forever and ever, amen. It does say that, you know, it does indicate that in the story. But that's the story. What was the story trying to convey? That something happened when Adam decided to break away from God and become independent of God. And what happened in that was sin. And that sin, as time went on, grew bigger and bigger and bigger until it was no longer just a little fissure between Adam and God. It was a wide gulf. It says in the story of Adam and Eve in Genesis that after Adam, they were banished from the garden. They had to kill an animal to cover themselves because they were embarrassed. They were a little naked. And then they had children, Cain and Abel. And Abel was righteous, and Cain could have been righteous, but got jealous of Abel and killed him in the fields. And then that went on to people killing more people, and people growing so wicked that they were raping each other, they were pillaging each other, they were burning each other's cities down, to the point where we get to the story of Noah, and God's like, enough already! Like, why did I create this wicked world? All because we sought independence. We sought ourselves over and above God. Now, I'm not saying that this is entirely a negative thing either, and there are some theologians that would look at what we call the fall in the Bible and would say that that fall actually was the very completion of creation. Because until we step out and we say, I am, and we start doing things independently, and then we make that decision to say, I love God, until that point, we can't really be in a loving relationship with God because we're not choosing to be in a loving relationship with God. So some theologians would say that this fall was even the very completion of creation, and that until man chose to step out on his or her own, they couldn't make that choice. But there can be no denying that as a result of that, some people chose the opposite of having a relationship with God. Many choose the opposite. Paul points us from despair to hope. For Christ is our Adam reboot. Christ is what it means to be truly human. In Christ, we see what a mutual relationship with God looks like. We see what we were created for, to depend on and have faith in God. To love, to serve, to build community, and to begin to allow God to redefine us from self-centered to community of God-centered. My friends, that's what we're all called to do. We're called to build the community of God and to be a part of it. Not to be the center of it, but to be a part of it. Oftentimes, when the church fails at its greatest, it's because of ego. It's because somebody or some group of people see their view and their way better than anybody else's. And when others disagree, there's division and strife, and rather than working together, we divide from one another because that person doesn't think the way I do, or that group doesn't want to do it the way I do. That's what causes division. It isn't so much when we look at the world that Christians are better than Muslims or that Buddhists are better than Hindus, but it's that on both sides there are people who think they're better than the other and are willing to kill each other for it. That ego is a killer. God is calling us to go from Adam to Christ, who is our Adam reboot, who is our Adam version 2.0, to use modern technological terminology. This is not easy because it goes against the very sinful tendencies that currently define us. But Jesus broke free from that very tomb of death. And so can we, if we just simply choose to acknowledge and to follow the resurrected one. Amen. Gracious and loving God, tonight's message is a challenge for all of us because each and every one of us sins. At the end of the day, because of our subjective nature, we live in ourselves. And at the end of the day, we only truly know ourselves if we even know ourselves wholly and fully. And so everything we see and everything we process comes through ourselves. And it is very hard for us, Lord, to separate ourselves from the picture. The beautiful thing, Lord, is that you haven't called us to separate ourselves from the picture, but rather to include other selves in with us. Not underneath us or above us or to the side of us, but along with us. Lord, help us to be a people that ever expand from our own ego and our own self-centered ways to being a people who build the community of God and put self aside in order to do it. We thank you and we praise you for this challenge, and we ask that you continually guide us in it. We pray these things in Jesus' name.